Hello everyone, this is Saurabh Kumar and I welcome you all to my video series where we are covering the syllabus of Certified Ethical Hacker. Today we have reached in part number 72 where we are going to talk about IDS and IPS. So basically these are both of them are actually a kind of device which people use in their organization to protect the network, to protect the PC. So here I will be talking about it, what exactly it is, how does it function, and how we can make sure or how we can configure it so that it works properly to protect our network or to protect our computer from any kind of malicious, maybe incoming connection. So here, let's have a look on it. First of all, in full, it is known as an intrusion detection system. The meaning is very much clear that this device, intrusion detection system, is going to detect any kind of intrusion if anything happens in our network, and it generates a report, or it you can say like it sends an alert. And not only alert, it can send so many different kind of message that depend on what kind of setting you are doing. Then we have IPS, which is intrusion prevention system. So intrusion prevention system will be even a more advanced level than IDS because it has automatic function to do any kind of, you know, task after detecting any kind of intrusion. So if any detection is will be there, automatically it knows how to take the action on it, or you can set some condition that if these things happen, what to do with it. Then both of them, when we talk about, actually there are separate devices available. Mostly if you talk about the big manufacturer or organization, they make separate devices, one for IDS, one for IPS, or either some of the firewall or some devices comes where it has a function of both of them. It has a function of IDS also, it has a function of IPS also. Even most of the firewall nowadays is having the function, basic function of IDS and IPS. If you are using maybe Cisco firewall, or if you are using CyberRoam, or if you are using any other Palo Alto network, so generally they have some basic feature of IDS and IPS there, where from you can configure it. Then the next point is IDS and IPS can be implemented before a firewall also, and it can be implemented after the firewall also. That completely depend, you know, on the requirement of it. For example, I have a network here. This is my organization network. So here maybe I have a router which is giving the maybe the internet, where from I connected to a switch, and switch is connected to all my PC. So after this router, we can have a firewall. And when we talk about the IDS and IPS, IDS and IPS can be either here after firewall, so that when incoming is already coming to firewall, it will be already opened, and then IDS will be able to even work better, when especially when we talk about application layer protection, or either it can be implemented even before firewall, so it can be like that. That depend on which kind of IDS you are using, which kind of IPS you are using, or what kind of function you are looking for. Then there can be a host based IDS and IPS also, which is available as a software. So for example, I have only one system, and on that system I want to maybe have IDS and IPS, means I want to protect only this PC. So the better method will be that rather than buying a hardware device as a IPS on IDS, the better idea will be that I will be using some software here, and that software will be working as a IDS and IPS. There are many number of software nowadays available over the internet which can be paid also. Some of them are free also, which you can download and you can try in your network to protect your computer from any kind of malicious incoming connection or malicious activity. So when we talk about the host based IPS or IDS, it will be generally available in a form of software which can be downloaded and installed on your machine, and you will be getting a graphic console where from you will be able to configure it also, what exactly or which kind of function you are looking for inside of it. Then IDS and IPS is also available as a physical device. So when we talk about the host as a IDS or IPS, we call it HIDS or HIPS. HIPS. And then when we talk about the devices, generally we call it network IDS and network IPS. So that is intrusion detection system for the network, intrusion prevention system for the network. So this is how actually this device, or maybe we can call it like a software, it is available in both format. You can buy a device also, which will be expensive, and it will be protecting your entire network. Like according to this diagram, I will be required to have a device rather than having a software, because it will be not possible to, you know, install IDS and IPS software on maybe thousands of machines. So better idea will be that we buy a hardware device and we put it before or after the firewall. Then IDS and IPS generally checks the malicious content on the basis of signature. So what exactly this line means, that it is trying to tell you that IDS and IPS is going to detect any kind of malware or any kind of malicious content on the basis of signature, and which is a bit kind of thing which we have to once again imagine about it, that it will be only able to stop those malicious content which is already known by the service provider, which is already known by the organization or the vendor of which or whom you are using the IDS and IPS device. So what generally they do, that whatever the malicious content is available over the internet, whatever malicious possible content are, they create or they detect their signature, and those signatures are being updated into the IDS device. So for example, if I buy a IDS device, maybe it is having some less number of signature, but it need to be keep updating so that whatever new signature comes in the market related to malicious content, that signature will be added to your IDS or IPS from your manufacturer or from your vendor of the IDS device, so that if the same content or signature of data passes through the IDS, it will be detecting that, okay, this is a malicious content, and it will be stopping them. So let's assume that there is a malicious content and which signature is something, for example, ABC, Z, something like that. So whenever any now any content is passing through IPS or IDS which has the same signature which is already added in your IPS and IDS device filtering, that means it will be detected as a malicious content, and it will be stopped here itself. It will be not be allowed to go or pass the IPS or IDS device. So that is the basic method how the IDS and IPS works. It contains some of the predefined signature, or the signature which is being added or deployed from the manufacturer or the vendor of the IDS and IPS device. It is there. And on the basis of that, IDS and IPS device check every packet, every content which is passing through it, and it is able to detect either it is a malicious or either it is not. But it can be a kind of a loophole also. For example, if there is a new malicious content available over the internet, and that malicious content maybe is not being properly known, or maybe it is not aware by the vendor of whom you are using the IPS and IDS, it may pass easily because the device is not having any signature inside of it which match with the content which is passing right now. So that is somehow a loophole also. So they are trying to work on it. They are trying to make or implement some other type kind of technologies as well, which I'm going to discuss in this video. So next point is, now IDS and IPS can also use a method which is known as anomaly. Anomaly method means what it is going to do actually is, it only rather than checking the signature, or rather than only matching the signature, now it is also going to look after that, is there any kind of session which is happening for the very long time, or maybe is it there any device which is generating or creating a session or establishing a session very many number of times in a specific given period. So if such kind of things happen also, your IDS and IPS detect it like something going wrong, and they may stop it. So you can read it about it, that what it is going to do is, it set with the how many number of session open at a given time. So in a given period time, how many a single device can have a session with your network, or maybe with your web server, or maybe with your DB server. So in case if that session number increases, and in that scenario, your IDS and IPS device is going to think like maybe a hacker is trying to establish the session with your device, and that's how it will be preventing, or it will be protecting your network from such kind of attack. Then there are so many number of IPS and IDS device which are also tied with the cloud service, which is also tied with so many number of IoT devices, which is also tied with so many cloud based services, where exactly it is always having the up to date, as well as those cloud based services or those cloud based service providers, they are having a complete record or track of what are the major vulnerable or what are the major known IP addresses who do or who does any kind of such activity. So they have the complete list of such IP addresses, malicious IP addresses or malicious range of IP addresses. And in case your network also get any kind of request from such kind of IP address, it will be detecting them as a malicious. It will be detecting them as a any kind of hacking activity, and it is going to protect your network from such kind of IP address. For example, let's take an example that any hacker is doing all the time some kind of activity relevant to maybe malware or relevant to anything which can be easily detected by IPS and IDS. So those cloud-based service providers, what they do generally is they put those IP address in the list of malicious activity list or maybe malicious IP address. So whenever your network will be getting any kind of request from such range of IP address or from such IP address, your IPS and IDS, because it is connected to the cloud-based or cloud-hosted service provider, in such scenario, it will get the information from the cloud and it will detect it as a malicious content. It will be detecting as a any kind of hacking going on, and then it is going to protect that. It is going to stop such kind of session immediately as soon as you detect that range of IP address. So that is also a good way. Most of the company, what they do actually is they have a complete proper tying up with the any cloud-based service to his IDS and IPS devices, so that whatever cloud service gets update, according to that update, his or her IDS or IPS device is also going to filter the traffic on the basis of IP address or IP address ranges. Then from many year of a popular and free IDS device, which is very most common nowadays, which is Snort, and which is very useful. I'm not branding again, but it is having a very nice function which can be used and test by you, and it is, I guess, freely available for testing purpose. So in case if you are having an interest to do some practical on IDS and IPS device, I will always recommend you that go and try for this particular software. Get this software, try to work on it, try to go through its console, try to look after what are the configuration it contains, try to configure it and test it. That will enhance your skill, that will enhance your knowledge in that particular area of IDS and IPS. So in case if you are having interest to work with this particular IDS and IPS software, which is known as Snort, what I am going to do is I am going to have a link here. So you can simply visit www.snort.org. By going to that website, you will be able to download also. Then to get it started, you have to first just register with your email ID. And then you will be able to download it. And once you download it, you will be able to use it. You will be able to get the console where from you can start practicing with it. So that will be a very nice method of having a hands-on experiment on IDS and IPS device. And we know that when you get the hands-on experience, you will be getting a much more clear concept about it, how exactly it is preventing your network from any kind of activity. Now I'm going to talk about evasion strategy. What are the different strategy which is being used, maybe to bypass the IDS, or maybe to crack the IPS, or maybe to pass through the IPS or IDS device, even to do the attack. So being an ethical hacker, you must be knowing what are the method attacker uses to do the attack, so that you can start working just on the same way, so that none of the attacker will be able to pass your IDS or IPS device. So very first thing what attacker may do, or attacker generally do, that they do the insertion process. The meaning is very clear that maybe they need to send a malicious code to your one of the web server. So let me take example here. Let's assume that you have a web server here, and your web server is obviously connected to a switch, and that switch is also connected to some of the computer, and then this switch connects to the router maybe here, and then this router is maybe connected to your firewall, and then this firewall is maybe connected to IDS or IPS. So what generally hacker will be doing, that maybe they need to reach to your network, or maybe you have a DMZ area of the firewall where you have the web server here. So what will be happening actually, that attacker will be maybe attacker need to send some of the packet which is a malicious, which supposed to reach to the web server to do the attack. So maybe they need to send some packet which is 1, 2, or maybe 1, 3, and 5. What attacker will do, that they know that if they send 1, 3, 5 packet all together at once, your IPS and IDS device is going to detect it as a malware. It is going to detect it as a malicious code, and then the connection will be stopped there only. So what attacker may do, that rather than sending only 3 packet, they will be sending 4, 5, 6 number of packet. They will be sending 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 like that. And then in this all packet, what they do generally do is they increase the TTL value for some of the packet which is not required. So for example, packet number, let's say that 2 is not required, 4 is not required, 6 is not required to reach to the server. So for those packeted, they will increase the TTL so that when this particular packet reaches to the IPS and IDS, up to there it is okay. And it is being checked by IPS and IDS, which is confusing them that my entire packet is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, which doesn't seems like, which doesn't match with any kind of signature value of malicious content. But once after the IDS and IPS, only part number 1, 3, and 5 will be passing, because rest of them, they have been already dropped out here. Because of their TTL, because of their time to life. So only 1, 3 and 5 packet reaches to the server, and server is getting actually nothing else, but it is getting the real malicious content to manipulate it. And that's how the first method, or the best method, hackers generally use to bypass the firewall, bypass the IDS and IPS device to reach up to the destination. And how they will be doing it? Very easily, they may use the trace route, where they may use ping minus S or ping hping command. They can use different tools, and by using that, they will be able to know how many number of devices they have up to the web server from the attacker PC, and according to that they can set the TTL value so that the malicious code will be able to reach up to the web server, but those extra added inserted number of packet, they will be dropped somewhere in the middle only. This is the one method which is being used by the attacker. Second method they can do is DOS attack. So what is DOS attack is going to do actually is, so maybe they will be first using a attacker PC, by which they will be doing any kind of condition by which they can do a denial of service attack. They may send maybe many number of packet to the IDS and IPS device, which will make confuse IDS and IPS, or which will give overload to IDS and IPS. And when this device will have a overload, it will not be able to work properly. And when it is not able to work properly, then attacker will start sending a malicious content, which will be easily passing from the IDS and IPS to reach up to the victim device, to reach up to the victim server, to reach up to victim network. So that can be the second method, that can be the another method by which any attacker may bypass the IDS and IPS devices. Third is, they may use also obfuscation, means attacker can use any kind of different coding, maybe ASCII, maybe Unicode, to change the real signature value to something else. As I have been discussing before, that maybe your IDS and IPS is having a list of some of the signature, and the signature is, if any content comes with ABCD signature, it is malicious. If it comes with ABCEF, then it is malicious. If it comes with ACDEF, it is malicious. So generally IDS and IPS is having a list of such kind of signature. But what if attacker does what? They use some kind of method of encryption, they may use some kind of languages to translate this signature into some different value which is not in their list. So maybe the malicious code which attacker want to send is having the signature that is ABCD, And he knows that it is a very well-known malware, so it can be easily detected by the IDS and IPS. So what he will do is, by using any of the code, he may change this value, which will now look like something different, maybe $@23, like that. So when this packet, this signature will be passing through the IDS and IPS, IPS and IDS will be checking with the list, and it will find that there is no such vulnerable content is available over the internet. So it will easily bypass them. It will allow them to pass it. And once this packet goes out from the IDS, from the firewall up to the web server already knows those kind of codes. So he will be able to read them. And once the web server is able to read, it is able to open. And once it opens, already the attack has been done. Already the server is manipulated by the attacker. So that can be the another method. So we have talked about one is ingestion, one we have is DOS, one we have is obfuscation. So these are the some of the method which is being used by the attacker to bypass or to break the IPS or IDS devices. Then some other method can be also used by the attacker and hacker is they may use session splicing. So when you do the session splicing means breaking the one session into multiple part. What happens generally that your IDS and IPS is having too much workload. So because of that, they have some random time limit of that it forget what it has checked before. So maybe one packet passes, it keeps the information up to next few seconds, 15 to 20 seconds. So that if any other next packet comes, it match with the previous packet so that combining those all 2-3 packets, is it trying to make something malicious? Is it trying to make something which is maybe malware? If not, then it allow. If it is, it stops there. Something same like, for example, you are being stopped at the airport to go with any kind of things like you cannot carry, you know, your even you are using maybe a gun or something, you are not allowed to pass. But what generally people who are having a mindset of doing any bad activity, they may do, they may try different idea. What they can do, maybe that there are maybe 5 people. So one people is carrying some part of that gun, then second one is having nothing, third one is having nothing, then fourth one is containing some part of the gun. So when this guy is only having some time limit of remember, this guy is passed with some part, then second one is having nothing, third one is having nothing, fourth one comes with some part. So they just match with this one and try to figure it out that after combining this all part, is it going to become a gun or not? So obviously it is not going to become, so it will allow even this guy. And that's how when they reach, then when they cross the airport, these two guys will sit together and they can combine their component to make it again something malicious. So that is how the attacker or the hacker also does. What they generally do that they pass some part of maybe the malware in a one packet, and then the second packet they don't send it immediately, they send it after 15 or 20 seconds, so that maybe the IPS and IDS device already may forget that what was the content of that packet which was sent from the attacker. So when the second packet comes, it detect like, no, it is not complete malware, it is just part of something which can be even used or which can be a part of any application or something. So it again pass the second packet, then again third packet comes after 30 second or maybe 20 second. So that's how each one by one packet it passes, and then when it reaches to the destination, they combine it all together, and that's how it becomes again a malware. That's how it becomes again a malicious content. So that is the another method that is called as a session splicing. Then we have fragmentation also, something similar like that. Fragmentation means again they mix it with some other kind of content, and the real content of the malware, they may keep it maybe one part somewhere else, another part somewhere else, another part somewhere else, and then they send it. And then once it reaches to the destination, they are again going to be fragmented by itself, and that's how defragmented by itself, and that's how it is going to become a malicious content. Then the next can be overlapping also. They can overlap with any other kind of condition, there another kind of content or maybe request. Then they can also have morph or polymorph. So these are some of the method which can be used easily by the attacker or a hacker to bypass any of the IDS and IPS devices. They may also use some kind of encapsulation method such as SSH, HTTPS and IPsec. So as we know that maybe we have a device within my network, maybe let's say that it is a server and there is another server. If two server is having a connection through the protocol such as SSH or through the HTTPS or through the IPsec, this guy will be always encrypting the data in such a way so that no any middle device, no any router, no any firewall, no any IDS device will be able to open that packet. And if they are not able to open it, obviously this packet is easily going to bypass and reach up to the destination. So that can be another method used by the attacker, that they use some kind of secure protocols so that whatever content is passing through, it will not be allowed to open for it. And that's why I always recommend to use actually IDS and IPS device after firewall, meaning that it should be like that. This is your network, for example. So in this network, you have your computers, you have maybe a switch connecting many number of computers, and then you are connected to a router and put here the IDS and IPS here after the firewall. So maybe this is your firewall, here you put IDS, here you put IPS. So that what will happening actually is that if any request comes from outside, now your firewall is going to break that packet. And you can set some kind of policy in your firewall so that it can break, it can even open all the packets. So once the packet is already open, now if it passes through the IDS and IPS, it will be able to check at the application layer. It will be even able to check or detect any packet at the upper layer, rather than only checking the lower layer like physical or data link or network. So in that scenario, your IDS and IPS device will be able to even detect any kind of malicious data or malicious content which is being sent through the any app or which is being sent through at the application layer. And that is how it is going to be protected. That is how your network can be more protected from such kind of attacker. So at the end of this video, what I will always recommend you, that go and do the practice with a snort. I'm not adding a snort practical in this video because of so many reasons. One is because of the time, and second is I want you to practice by your own because it requires a registration. So better, I have already used my email ID so many times. So you can go download it, registered with your email ID, and try to do practice on it. And that will give you, or that will make you more confident in the topic of IDS and IPS. So I hope in this video I have tried to added all those basic content or basic information of IDS and IPS relevant to the course of CEH. And I hope this was informative for you all. And I would like to thank you for watching.